Well, good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee's 11th meeting of 2017. Apologies have been received from Mary Fee, and I welcome Claire Baker, who is attending as her substitute. Agenda item number one, decision on taking business in private. Is the committee content to take item four, which is consideration of the key issues emerging from the evidence received on the Limitation Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill at stage one in private? Agreed. Thank you. And agenda item, oh yeah. And are we agreed to consider the draft Stage 1 reports on the Limitation Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill and the Railway Policing Scotland Bill in private and future meetings? Agreed. Thank you for that. Agenda item number 2 is our third evidence session on the Railway Policing Scotland Bill, and I refer members to paper 1, which is a note by the clerk, and paper 2, which is a spice paper, and to the written submissions provided by some of the witnesses. And I thank TransPennine and CrossCountry for their submissions. I welcome to the panel Andrew Cooper, Managing Director of CrossCountry; Neil Curtis, Head of Compliance, Direct Rail Services Limited; David Lister, Safety, Sustainability and Assurance Director, ScotRail Alliance; Graham Meiklejohn, Regional Development Manager, TransPennine Express; and Darren Horley, Commercial and Operations Strategy Manager, Virgin Trains. Thank you, gentlemen. I hope you didn't have any difficulty getting here this morning in adverse weather conditions. We'll go straight to questions. Can I have questions from members? Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, convener. It's by nature of things a relatively general and open question, but I think will lead to other things. Would it be correct to say that the rail operating companies that you represent's primary interest in relation to the future of policing on our railway network is twofold? First of all, that it is an effective service that meets the needs of security in the network, and secondly, that it needs to be delivered at a price that's appropriate, given that it's a commercial relationship you have with the policing. And just, do you have concerns on either of these issues at the outset? And I'm sure that will enable other members to take this elsewhere. Kind of right to left, I suspect, would be good enough, unless you have another view.
Good morning. Thanks for the opportunity to attend this morning. I think it's quite right to say that it's a commercial relationship, so the price matters. We're running a business, and we have very clear relationships with the police service at the moment. And it also needs to be, as you say, effective, because particularly in the case of handling the railway when it doesn't work effectively, whatever the cause of disruption, and sometimes we have to call on the services of the police, it's a priority for customers, and that comes through very loud and clear in all the National Passenger Survey tracking research that's done every year, that handling delays and problems in operating the railway are an absolute priority for our customers.
In regards to commercial aspect, it is an important aspect to ensure that we're receiving value for money and the services that those give as well. Being a freight operating company, we have a requirement to work throughout the whole country, not just through franchises, station to station. So we have a different kind of requirement of BTP. Not only in regards to services that provide on general day-to-day services, but also when things, as Andrew said earlier, start to go wrong. Highly important to our organisation to ensure that we have that support as and when it's required, and they fully understand our business needs as well, which in some instances is quite technical.
We may come back to this. Can I just ask, do DRS operate services out with the GB network across the Channel and elsewhere in Europe?
No.
Although other freight operators certainly do.
No, we're UK bound.
Right, well, in that case, I won't ask the supplementary.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to give evidence here today. I'm representing both the ScotRail Alliance, so both Network Rail in Scotland and Abellio ScotRail. And for both halves of the alliance, just as you say, overridingly the safety and security on the railway and making sure that we minimise any impact to disruption on the railway as a result of any crime or disorder is paramount to us in terms of the policing of the railways. And equally, the commercial side of that is important, again, for both halves of the alliance, as it is a commercial arrangement.
Okay. Thank you very much. Good morning. We fully agree with the comments that have been made, both in terms of the importance of the services provided and the significant reassurance that it gives to passengers on the network and the support operationally when things do go wrong to recover and to have trains running back as they should do going forward. I think it's imperative to say that the BTP across the network that we operate are integral partner to the delivery of our operations and they're seen to be connected and with all operators in a seamless delivery of service to the travelling public. And as a cross-border operator who's based predominantly in the north of England and also connecting to Lockerbie, Glasgow and Edinburgh, we see a lot of officers that we work with in the BTP today who have begun their careers over in Kilcadden's in Glasgow, but they've ended up in Manchester and they've ultimately transferred back up to north of the border. So the definite career progression that they've enjoyed so far, and it's that skill set and that knowledge of the network across the north and into Scotland, which we obviously benefit from on a day-to-day service delivery viewpoint.
Good morning, Dan from Virgin Trains. As you can appreciate, our network runs from London right through to Scotland, so we enjoy the BTP right from one end of the country to Scotland itself. It is a commercial relationship, and it is actually a partnering relationship rather than a partnership. So we want to see that continuity stay throughout our operations. First and foremost, it's a safe railway, and that's the role that the BTP play. We want to see that continuity yet again. In terms of the business needs, we want a reassurance that our customers are safe, first and foremost, our staff are safe at stations, and it's commercially effective to the railway, and as my colleagues to my left have quite pointed out in terms of the commercial operations, it is quite imperative that the minimal disruption is caused between the splitting force. So.
You made a distinct, this is my final point, Camilla, for the moment at least. You made a distinction between partnership and partnering, which I don't fully understand. Would you like to explain it to me, please?
In terms of a partnership, you tend to run things jointly. A partnering relationship, in my term, is that you do it together. You've got the same outputs and the same goals, and you share the outcomes. So that's it's a partnering relationship, in my view, in terms of the police know what our common goal and our focus by our joint focus. And strategy is.
So is that similar to the Abellio Network Rail partnering?
It is
similar sort of idea?
Yes.
Right, that's fine. Convener.
No. Thank you. Good morning. The Scottish Government's policies to provide railway policing agreements between industry and the police in Scotland and they'll replace the police service agreements. Just wondering if you've any particular concerns about the Government's proposals with regard to the railway policing agreements?
I think they'll be slightly different from the arrangement we have at the moment, where we are dealing with a police force that's exclusively serving the railway. I think there's an added complexity when we're trying to agree a contract with a body that's got much broader policing requirements. We would need to be much more confident that the things that we're seeing at the moment, which are really in most of the paperwork that I've seen are really stated commitments, but we need to be assured through that contract that those things will be delivered. So I think it's going to be subtly different from the arrangement that we currently have with the British Transport Police, just simply because we're contracting with a body that's is intending to have a specialism but is not dedicated to serving the railway.
What specific differences do you mean when you talk about that?
Well, at the moment, when we sign an agreement with the British Transport Police Authority, we know that their interests are exclusively for the railway. We know that the body is set up by the Department of Transport and has objectives which these days are better aligned with those of the industry than I've ever seen in my railway career. So we're in a very strong position there. it's hard to see that it will be quite as easy for Police Scotland to be able to put themselves in that position, because they have much more, much broader obligations for policing in Scotland. So I think we would need to be much more confident and therefore probably much more prescriptive in any agreements we had with Police Scotland, as opposed to the dedicated force that is the British Transport Police.
Police Scotland have given us reassurances that they will very much treat it as a specialist service which won't be compromised. You'll appreciate we've heard that evidence from them. Anyone else have a view on it?
I think our focus is more about ensuring that the BTP continues to play the same critical role, as I mentioned previously, about keeping the travelling public and ourselves, our staff, and that's safe. So in terms of if Police Scotland, in terms of its take over BTP, can honour that and give us the guarantees in terms of the same service and level of service we enjoy from the British Transport Police, which the Transport Minister has said, he said himself he can give us reassurances, and we are looking for that written reassurances that I can give to staff. We are no objections to the reforms, but we do need that reassurance for the points that my colleague Andy Cooper has pointed out.
As well, obviously, as a freight operating company, we have a different requirement to the passenger groups who are operating through stations and main lines in the main. We operate right the way out throughout the UK. Some branch lines that we're the only operator that operate down those areas. And freight has a distinct difference of requirement. And as both my colleagues have said earlier, that it is a requirement. We do fully support the changes, but we do need that guarantee that what we've currently got is maintained, or if in fact we can improve, that's always the best way to go forward.
Thank you.
One more aspect that just adding to the comments made by colleagues is I think we should recognise that the Minister's been very generous in time that's been given so far, and there's almost been an evolution in some of the comments that we've been making, particularly those that affect operations south of the border. And mentioned earlier that we're predominantly based in the north of England. Our concern is what happens when you cross the border from one force to another. That degree of cooperation is there today, and it's been reassured that we definitely have that going forward. We think going forward, and we've mentioned it in the written evidence that we've provided, the ability to have some sort of agreement between the force in Scotland and the BTP south of the border, just to ensure there's continuity, there's no issues or the risk of misunderstandings as services pass to and fro over the border, probably would be a wise path to be taken, just to ensure that that cooperation is founded from day one. But I think, given where we've started from with those early discussions with the Minister, that's really been understood and taken on by the officials.
That's encouraging. Thank you. Thank you.
If I could ask a little bit more about the railway policing agreements. There's a concern expressed today and in some of the other evidence we've heard that Police Scotland is taking over this function, the railway function, whereas perhaps the emphasis before was more on the railway transport side of things. And I think, was it ScotRail perhaps suggested that a way around that might be to look at a specialist board? Could maybe comment further than that and hear other views on that?
Thank you, Convener. In our evidence, we did talk about a specialist board, and as you'll have seen in the legislation, what's been proposed is a management forum. So not quite a board, but moving along that direction. So it's encouraging that some of the requests that we've been making have made their way through to the legislation. But one of the areas, just talking about railway policing agreements and police service agreements that exist today, is that the industry, and I believe evidence has been given by the Railway Development Group in relation to the existing police service agreements, are under discussion in the UK as seen as desirable to improve those. And I think it's important that when the railway agreements are put in place, that it's not taken that we just adopt the exact same style as the existing police service agreements. Mm-hmm. I think the other aspect that we see is important to take into consideration, so that the governance and ensuring that railway priorities are kept as part of the overall standards for Police Scotland would be really important for us as a railway industry going forward. The setting up of a management forum is a good start, but one of the areas that we are conscious of is that for the BTP, where you have BTPA, whose entire focus is on the railway, the policing of the railway, so the governance is entirely focused on that, whereas in Police Scotland, the railway policing will be a relatively small aspect for the wider policing for Scotland. Now, we have been reassured that the the police authority, the Scottish Police Authority, are looking to get some railway experience onto the SPA board, but that's something that we would see as really important in order to ensure that railway interests are not only seen by the dedicated railway police management, but also considered by the Scottish Police Authority.
I suppose taking that a little bit further then, the reason why we're led to believe this is really important is understanding the railway and understanding the problems that can arise there is germane to the policing of it, to minimising disruptions. Could you perhaps elaborate on that side of things a little bit? Because that's certainly becoming true. Be interested to hear your views.
Certainly, thank you, Convener. It's really important for the industry to, as we've said, to ensure that there is minimal disruption, that our staff remain confident, that the travelling public remain confident with the services provided. And the British Transport Police specialism enables them to have the appropriate balance, and they do it very effectively to ensure that they balance the needs of investigating crime, managing incidents, and also looking to the needs that the travelling public have to be travelling, and therefore getting the network back into operation as quickly as possible, and be that responding to a bomb threat incident and making the appropriate threat assessment so that they can balance the risks there, or be that dealing with a fatality, etc. They're able to do that very effectively. As has already been said, that we've had good engagement with the Transport Minister in relation to the proposals, and with BTP and the Police Scotland. So we are getting reassurances that specialism will be retained, but that's clearly very important to us as an industry.
Any other views? Mr. Cooper?
Yeah, in paranoia in my evidence to you, I made the comment, whilst the BTP naturally has a thorough understanding of its duties and obligations to police independently, it balances that with its role as a service funded directly by the industry. So the approach that officers take when they're dealing with issues on the railway, which as my colleague has said, are very often based on experience, knowledge, lots of empirical data that enable them to make a risk assessment of the situation that faces them. Because it's, in a sense, a controlled environment, they know what they're looking for on a railway, and they know what the likely externalities are, which is not always the case, as it were, on the high street. And therefore, BTP officers are able to take a decision which is in the best interest of the railway and the passengers who are travelling, and the wider implications of the decisions they take, because obviously we're running a network across the whole of the country, which is not, in our experience when we deal with Home Department forces back in England, it's not always the case. And I think there's a distinction to be drawn between having a force that's got a specialism within it, and within 17,000 officers in Police Scotland, it's not going to be easy to see how that specialism can be too widespread, and having a force that's absolutely dedicated and therefore has an ethos and approach to policing the railway, which is in the best interest both of ensuring the safety of passengers and the public, but also making sure that there aren't any unintended consequences from their actions.
Mr. Horley?
Yeah, just to echo my colleague Andy Cooper says, it's first and foremost, it's a force that's funded by the industry through the fare-paying passenger. And the BTP have a special in terms of managing the incidents on the rail network that are very, very different to the high street. And in my experience, a recent incident at the Lockerbie area, where the civil police attended a suicide, and I appreciate there were some complicated matters, but the way our staff, my driver, was treated in terms of taken off site and questioned as if he's a victim in this, was a lot different to how the BTP would handle an incident. So there's a lot of nervousness around our staff, how they're going to be treated in such instances. So it's critical for us as a business and giving that reassurance to staff and the passengers.
Okay. Any other comments from anyone else? Mr. Carter?
I think it also, just to add to the comments, and we've mentioned about cross-border transfers, both north and south. A couple of concerns, really, is the BTP is a specialist force within the rail industry. The terminology within the rail industry can be quite complicated. I started in the rail industry at 98 and thought it was something new and bright, and I'm still learning terminology now. And one thing I would be concerned about, and we've been given some assurances or reassurances that it will be looked at, is in regards to the education of Police Scotland officers who may be asked to attend a situation such as Darren talks about earlier. But what concerns me is the misunderstanding of terminology, misunderstanding of the rail industry in its entirety, because it is complex in some ways. And they may come across some things that will never ever see on normal highways or within public areas in general policing forms. So it has to be fully understood. It isn't just a simple policing the railways is one thing, policing the highways is another thing. The complexity of railways is quite something to understand.
Can you give any example of the terminology that might cause a problem? If not, you can come back and provide us with that information.
Well, just track terminology. I think there's certain things you'd be talking about, the forefoot and different terminology mm-hmm. that people work on the railways will just give out as normal discussion points. And those kind of things can lead to a misunderstanding or put officers at risk as well. That's the, one thing, there's an incident occurs, but what we don't want to do is escalate it any higher than what it already is. And putting people out onto the railways where some instances 125 mile an hour lines with big trains that don't stop very quickly at all. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're looking at a mile or so for some of the bigger trains to stop. It is a very dangerous environment.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Farley,
sorry. So just to give one example, actually, quite local to me in terms of places on the railways, a place called Wichner in just north of West Midlands. The actual junction of the railway is in Wichner, but the village Wichner is 50 miles away, near enough. It's quite a distance away. So in terms of terminology, it is quite a complex system to get your head around. So that may lead on to questions later about the control centre, because that's some of the areas of concerns mm-hmm. that we have. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you for that. Supplementary, John Finney, and then Douglas Loss and Liam.
Good morning, panel, and thanks for your evidence. It's to pick up, if I may, convener, on the railway policing arrangements and a comment made by Mr. Curtis, and that was the potential for the arrangements to be improved as a result of this change. And indeed, Mr. Cooper talked about the extent to which the specialism was widespread. This is a question particularly for Mr. Lister and Mr. Curtis, whose area. As a representative for the Highlands and Islands, and I wouldn't ordinarily have put this on the record, but the Chief Constable of BTP did last week, there are five officers cover that area, five BTP officers. That's, I've been trying to do my sums, but 300-400 miles of track. Now, within that area, there are several hundred Police Scotland officers, dozens of detectives, dogs and all the rest. The potential does exist to enhance the policing arrangements, the reality being in many instances that it won't be a BT officer who attends an incident. Would you agree with that?
It does happen. I think all mutual aid occurs within the policing authorities within the UK anyway. It's a requirement under the Policing Act. But we know that if we have an incident in certain locations, there's a good chance that a Police Scotland person will turn up. An officer will turn up and deal with the incident. And that does occur, yes.
And I would concur with that also. It's something that happens today, and as the forces have become integrated, that integration could assist that particular element of the response.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Horley.
I concur with those statements, and let's not be mistaken. This is an opportunity, for more coverage. But we've just gone through some questions and answers in terms of the expertise that these officers will have when they step foot onto a railway environment. That's what's most critical. So from a Virgin Trains point of view, it is an opportunity. Let's get it right, but it's about the right expertise and the right training these guys will have.
Mm-hmm. Clear. Is it a supplementary to something that's been raised, or can I add you to the list? That would be later. I'll put you on the list. Douglas and then Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Can I first of all ask Mr. Cooper, you say in your evidence that you held discussions with the Police Division of Scottish Government back in 2013. Were there moves by the Scottish Government to change BTP in Scotland at that time, and what were the plans?
I think it was that this was a proposition, and they wrote and asked, they approached us and asked for our views, which we were very happy to give. I think they were consulting more widely than that at the time, informally, not consulting in the way that happened more recently. We were asked for a view and we gave it from Scottish Government.
And you say in your evidence you sent back a very comprehensive response in, I think, October 2013. Would it be fair to say at that time you were not convinced of merging BTP D Division within Police Scotland or within a single force, which had only just started earlier on that year? And certainly, I think my point is, did you warn the government against that move?
Yeah, the views I expressed at the time when approached were expressing the view that it seemed like quite a brave step to take, because I don't think it was policy at the time, it was being considered. The issues have been explained by a number of the people who submitted evidence here, the operational concerns and other issues that surrounded it. It seemed to us that there wasn't a particularly strong case for making a change at the time, and certainly the three benefits that are put forward here as a reason for the policy decision that's been taken weren't something that was being discussed at the time.
I think that's useful to get for the record, because obviously we hear a lot in this committee and during this debate that it's because the Smith Commission devolved powers to allow the Scottish Government to do this. This is why we're now looking to integrate BTP within Police Scotland, but it seems there was a move afoot towards that earlier. Could I perhaps ask you another specific question?
Please.
On your evidence, but I'd appreciate comments from other members. You say at paragraph 15 that as an operator, it feels right to be concerned that the transfer of part of the BTP to Police Scotland in a period when the force has its own significant challenges to meet presents new risk to railway policing. How do you compare your evidence to the evidence this committee received from ACC Higgins of Police Scotland, who said actually he felt it was a luxury to have 2 years to prepare for this? Do you think it is a luxury that we've got 2 years to prepare for this, or will you continue to have your concerns about merging BTP into Police Scotland?
Well, I think it comes back to the issue about stated intentions and what we really mean by assurance. And a significant change like this, I would normally expect in business life to be accompanied by a proper impact assessment of what the likely consequences, unintended consequences and so on would be. And equally, there's a comment I know in some of the paperwork that's been shared that suggests, it's just changing cap bags and the sticker on the side of the police vehicle is all that's required to get things going. Well, when we're establishing a new franchise, having been awarded one, which we were in my case back in 2007, there's a 4 or 5 months period of mobilisation, which involves an awful lot of things that have to be ready for day one when a transfer is made. And I haven't seen much evidence in what I've been able to read here that sort of mobilisation plan and the issues that are really important to ensure that whenever that day one comes, it's a seamless event, don't appear to be there, which is the sort of thing that gives me as an operator some concern. Because obviously the subordinate legislation is very important and that's the way things are structured. But of course, a lot of the things that people want to work through in those things are not worked through at this stage and therefore must remain kind of stated intentions, which I'm sure are given in good faith and based on experience, but they're not kind of proven at this stage, I think.
Yeah, I would agree with Mr. Cooper that clearly it's really important that planning and preparation is put in place to achieve this. And you know, so I think 2 years is certainly an achievable time frame for that. But you know, significant work needs to be taking place now in order to ensure that just as Mr. Cooper raises there, that the appropriate planning and mobilisation and risk management is put in place. At the recent meeting that we had with the Minister, Transport Scotland, BTP, BTPA, and the Police Authority, there was discussion around the work activities that are taking place and the desire to get the industry involved in many of those work streams. So, you know, I see the starting process happening for that, but it's at an early stage, and it's important that that continues and that the industry is heavily involved in it.
Just to add on to the points being made, I think the key point about what the industry does from a mobilisation viewpoint is a good case point, and it's one that the BTP today are involved in when you move from one operator to another, and some of the changes in the relationship that the incoming franchise might have in terms of what goes forward today for TransPennine Express. We have a far closer relationship since April last year than we had before that, given how we're working with them. And I think it's that sort of opportunity over a two-year period to make sure that all the planning and all the assessments which we would do during mobilisation in a couple of months can be delivered over 2 years. But the ultimate imperative test is that when you move to day one, when change happens, as we are remitted to do, the customer, the passenger, sees no difference. Everything continues as normal, ultimately, hopefully, enhancement. But there's no impact on day-to-day operations and day-to-day security of the railway.
Just in regards to the mention of you've got 2 years to deal with this, that just breaks down to 104 weeks of work. And having worked in projects and various other things, that's not a long piece of time to make sure that you've got a plan in place. As Andrew has mentioned earlier about looking and planning ahead of time, looking, as we've mentioned in a couple of the workshops, if we're operators, we need to do a management of change process, which is looking and reviewing and identifying risks within the process. Looking at dispositions between roles within BTP going into Police Scotland, key kind of actions that need to be considered and understood fully to ensure that one little bit doesn't suddenly get missed, which is actually a key kind of operation or practice that's done by one officer or a couple of officers that then suddenly gets missed as not being important. Failure at that point is then could be quite dramatic, and we all know how that can affect businesses across the country, etc., if one item suddenly fails. So I would encourage just a reminder, 2 years is not a long piece of time in anybody's business. It changes very quickly, and I would encourage anybody that's involved in looking and reviewing this is ensure that they've looked at the risks associated with the transfer, looked at the dispositions between BTP and Police Scotland, and ensured in that it's fully charted and fully recorded. We're willing to be involved in that process, and we've offered our services in that to review and ensure that, you know, a suitable process is taken forward in regards this this bill. So hopefully that gives a bit of a insight.
Mr. Lister, I wonder if I could come on to your evidence and just get it on the record what you put in your written submission about a fatality in Carluke Station. I think it's useful, given some of the discussions we've had about BTP officers maybe not being first on scene or working alongside Police Scotland. You say in your evidence that a fatality was deemed a suicide by BTP officers in 73 minutes and therefore the railway could be reopened, but the conventional Police Scotland force wished to continue investigations and that meant it was closed for a further 107 minutes. Could you maybe give us more detail in that example?
Well, you're correct. That is a detail in relation to that incident, and in essence, because the initial response was from Police Scotland, and a different approach was taken in relation to the investigation of the incident itself. It protracted the length of time that the railway was shut, and you're aware that obviously the network, particularly where you're talking about the main lines, has an impact not just in Scotland, but it will transfer all the way through down to London. So the overall impact across the railway becomes significant, disrupting many, many passenger journeys and leading to costs to the industry as well as to costs to the wider society. However, one area I can say is that in discussions that we have had with Police Scotland and BTP and Transport Scotland, one of the areas that Police Scotland have recognised is the specialism and the expertise that the Transport Police have in this area, and the fact that it's a best practice that potentially could transfer into the Police Scotland. So providing that is something that is taken forward and that is delivered, then that could be encouraging in terms of delivering that wider benefit, not necessarily just in the railway industry, but it's extremely important for us to ensure that the response is taking that balanced view.
I just want to finish on that point of training, but just with this example, suicide was the confirmed outcome, is that correct? Therefore, BTP were correct in their assumption after 73 minutes, but the further delay by Police Scotland resulted in a 760-minute delay to the entire rail network, costing approximately £160,000. Yet we're saying, just so for the record, that the correct outcome was established earlier by BTP officers. Finally, can I ask, first of all, to yourself about the governance and then the entire panel about training. In your evidence, and you mentioned it earlier, about the SPA having a dedicated transport person within their board, would you have serious concerns if they are unable to recruit someone? Therefore, if they go, there's currently two vacancies and they're looking to fill that at the moment. If they can't fill that vacancy with someone with a transport background, or there is any point during the SPA's time that the person with a transport background is unable to attend or unable to be a member of the SPA, what would your concerns be that decisions would be taken potentially the only member with a transport background is not there? And given that the convener will want me to move on, can I ask my final question? We've heard from ACC Higgins and Police Scotland about their training proposals for the new officers coming in, and indeed a specialist group, and for all 17,000 odd police officers. Have you taken reassurance from the training that has been suggested? I have my own concerns that it's just a couple of weeks added on at the end. Other members think that it's sufficient, and I just wonder, based on the evidence you've received, and we're seeking further evidence from Police Scotland, are you satisfied that there will be sufficient training for officers, that they will have the sufficient certificates to police the railway, to go onto the railway if required, or do you remain concerned about some of the aspects of training that will be required for BTP officers when they merge into Police Scotland?
Okay, so if I answer the first question in relation to the governance piece, The key element is ensuring that, as the strategy is developed going forward for Police Scotland, there is a consideration for the railway policing within that strategy. And so it's not for me to say exactly how that should be achieved. And we have suggested that one of those mechanisms would be to have that railway experience on the SPA board. Obviously, the legislation talks about the management forum that will channel the railway input into the board. But the key element for us is to ensure that going forward, there is serious railway consideration in relation to the governance of Police Scotland, so that it's not just a minor consideration, it's something that features in the overall strategy for Police Scotland. Moving on to your second question around training, the only detail I've seen on the training so far was with the evidence that was given here, and as I say, I understand that is an additional 2 weeks to the training for all Police Scotland officers should the merger take place. And the existing training at the moment is I believe 3 weeks dedicated training that's provided to the BTP police officers, that gives them both the personal track safety requirements, as well as training in railway bylaws and dealing with fatality management, etc. So it does feel that that's something that could be a benefit in terms of enhancing the overall capability. The most critical thing from the railway perspective is, as was talked about earlier, is to ensure that those people who are accessing the railway are doing it following the appropriate procedures and understand the risks that are associated with.
Important point would be, it's not just 2 to 3 weeks when they become a new constable, when they're learning everything about policing, it's that ongoing training, so you don't lose that specialist knowledge, the terminology, that is a significant risk, that if we just tick a box to say, well, they've had this extra 3 weeks, and then they never do anything with railway policing, maybe for 20 years, and then get called to an incident, they don't have any knowledge at all.
Well, what we would be interested to see is the details in relation to what the proposal is, what the plan for retention of skills is the current arrangements, and it's industry-wide, is that there's a two-year refreshment on that training, so that it's not something that you can not practice forever or not be retrained and still retain the competence. So we would want to understand what the proposal was going forward.
I think just to add to David's point there is continual training needs to be part and parcel of the training programme. It can't be ignored. We as operators and staff who work on there are required to ensure we've got competent and suitable staff to carry out duties. Having 2-3 weeks, whatever it's going to be, of training is a good start, but it's a start. It's not a completion of work. It has to take into account, how often are you going to be going and using that knowledge. You will get knowledge wane, it'll disappear and it'll fade away, and you've got to have that continuous training. We do also have probation periods as well for people going into, from initiating, from getting a PTS, getting other qualifications that will allow you to access the railways. That we don't allow people just to go straight on and with a certification. They need to be escorted, they need to be managed, they need to gain that knowledge through experience of walking on there with an experienced person. So in answer to that, we've seen that there's talk about the training. It needs to be fully understood what that means. It also needs to recognise what the rest of the industry are doing, both for track workers, railway operators generally, of what we're required to do under the rules of the railways. To go back to your first question, which was in regards having a recognised person on the board, I think it is highly important. Otherwise, decisions can be made under assumption, and assumption can be the can lead you down to an expensive route of failure.
I mean, you asked three questions. I think the issue of membership, you're quite right, it's important that somebody's there. And I think, it's beholden on us as an industry, if we're serious about this, to make sure that there are people available, whether they're sort of volunteers from elsewhere or whether the industry produces some names from which, the police authority can select. But I think it's our duty to make sure that the representation is there. I think decisions, you're quite right, the operational decisions which might be taken or strategic decisions might be taken by the authority are an important part of it, but the operational decisions at a lower level are both important, and they won't be directly influenced by membership on the board, which really takes us on to your third point. Yeah, core policing is 10 weeks training, I think, and we take them away, and 3 weeks training is given for railway police on the BTP. One can give them personal track safety certification in a couple of days, but a couple of days times 17,000 officers, if that was what was being proposed, which is how I read it, is quite a sum and quite a challenge, because you've got to release those officers for that training, just as they have for the other things where they need refresher training, firearms and all the other things that come with it. So it's quite an obligation taking people away from the coalface, as it were, for that training. But I think also it's the fact that a dedicated force has people who are gaining experience over time dealing with similar sorts of incident. And I think that's the thing where experience is gained, and knowledge and the sort of approach to policing on the railway, which is gained just simply by being dedicated to it all of the time and with colleagues who are as well. You have to have a competence management system. If you take drivers for trains, we have a competence management system which takes account of the fact that drivers may be driving for 6 months and not have any sort of incident at all. So we put them through that on simulations and various exams and tests and so on over a period of 3 years. And there's a competence management file, which is a requirement on us to make sure that they're fit to operate and safe to do so and have the knowledge and experience. And I think a police force as an employer would have, the agents of the Crown here would have to make sure that they had a competence management system for people they put in harm's way on the railway. You can develop those things, but they're not without cost. And if you're going to spread it throughout the force, which is what was being suggested there, there's going to be quite a price tag attached, because there is simply time, the need to release people from their day job to enable them to go through the stages of such a competence management system.
On a particular point raised here?
Supplementary on a point that was raised earlier. If that's okay, convener, thank you. David Lister, you talked about preliminary discussions with the Scottish Government and other relevant parties, and in answer to Douglas Ross and Graham Meiklejohn, you also touched on it with in answer to Ronan and Mackay. I just wanted to question whether those discussions with the Scottish Government or other relevant parties had given you a reassurance that the engagement proposed will give you a sufficient voice in setting railway policing priorities and objectives following integration, both in terms of mobilisation and going forward, if that is the will of Parliament. I just wanted to be absolutely clear on that.
Thank you. Yes, as Mr. Meiklejohn indicated, that the Minister has been generous with his time, and there's been four meetings with the industry since the middle of last year to talk through the process, both pre the legislation being drafted and post the legislation being published, or the draft legislation being published. And in that, it's given us the opportunity to raise any fears or concerns that we may have in terms of the process and enable reassurances to be mentioned in those. So in relation to the governance, there have been reassurances there in terms of the government's arrangements will be fully taking into account the industry's views. But I guess the point I was making earlier is in relation to governance. The one piece that's not in the legislation is in relation to the SPA and the railway representative on that, and that's one area that we would like to see strengthened, as it were.
Overall, you're reassured by the level of engagement?
Correct. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Liam, followed by Claire and Murray.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to follow up one of the lines of questions that Douglas Ross had initiated there in terms of the training. I think a separate issue that's been raised with us is the extent of unease within BTP itself. And from the witnesses last week, I think it emerged that around about 40% of staff in a recent staff survey had indicated that they were at least considering whether or not their future lay within BTP. And back to the point, I think, Mr. Horley, you mentioned that this is about the seamlessness with which we transition from what's in place now to what's in place in the future. I mean, does it give rise to some concerns for you if there is such a significant cohort within the existing BTP officers and staff who are at least considering whether or not at the point of transition that's a transition they want to make?
Absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt, that does concern us. And my colleague Graham mentioned earlier about the importance of the police training and their own progression within the force. So it's critical for us that between, from London right through to Scotland itself, that we have a seamless force in place, and the training is all that's better, at the same standard it is today, or better, and that the officers involved are dedicated and they don't see that their futures are being demised because of a change in their reporting lines.
Is there a view across the panel as to whether or not there's a certain amount of critical mass within the BTP at the moment in terms of its expertise across a range of different areas that would need to be retained at least for the foreseeable future in the early stages of that transition to ensure that that was a smooth transition?
Well, I think in a way you make an interesting point, because I'm less concerned once mobilisation has gone through about years one and two after a significant change like this. I think my concerns would be on years three and four and beyond, what really happens, because the intentions that everybody has right at the start of these things are always very firm and very well held, but of course a lot of other pressures can come to bear. And I think my concern would be that, having entered into this venture, where do we stand in three, four, 5 years' time? Because the railways are a long-term business. Franchises are, reasonably lengthy. And we really want to be assured that those things will be there in the future. Mm. I think the comment I'd make, for more than the last 25 years, I've been leading railway companies with various numbers of staff. I have about 1,800 people at the moment. And when you're dealing with people who work largely as lone workers as part of a team, the issues around leadership and their belief and how they feel about work and whether they understand the plot, if I can put it that way, is of fundamental importance. And I think it will be interesting to see the report from Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary, both in England and Wales and in Scotland, to see what their review of British Transport Police is. And I believe that they will find that one of the strengths of BTP is leadership. And, you know, I've known personally the last three chief constables and seen the work that they have done, which has brought the British Transport Police to the position it is at the moment, which is the best I've ever seen in terms of its alignment with the industry. So to find that 40% of the officers in Scotland as part of BTP are very concerned about this, given the strength of leadership that I witness, would be a real concern. Because, you know, those people are well-led, understand the plot, and are very committed to the job that they do, and yet they now have this concern. And therefore, as an operator who relies on them to provide the service that they're contracted to do, yes, I am concerned. Mm-hmm.
Just taking on to, again, a point I think you made earlier on about a requirement for a greater level of sort of specification in whatever the RPAs begin to look like. Given the two-year time frame that we're looking at for implementation, would you see it as essential to have some of that specific detail mapped out sooner rather than later, in the sense that that's the specific details of what maybe in the RPAs will presumably guide the decisions that are taken by SPA and Police Scotland at the point and immediately after transfer?
I think so. If there's a willingness between two parties to reach agreement, then it can easily be on in that timescale. But it's making sure that both parties really understand the position that others have and their concerns so that we can find, you know, that meeting of minds. So, you know, I don't see it's impossible to do that. But it is a greater challenge than if you're dealing with an organisation like the British Transport Police, where, in a sense, it's a zero-sum game. We know they look after railways and we run railways. Whereas there are going to be many other pressures, some of which are illustrated in the Police 2026 document that I've read through. So Police Scotland is not without its own pressures, and it's got to consider those properly as well in fulfilling its duties in Scotland, as it has when it enters into a contract with railway operators for police services in Scotland.
And what assurances have you had around that? Because I noticed in earlier evidence there were some concerns around the way in which policing agreements operate at the moment in terms of perhaps a lack of clarity around precisely what it is that's being paid for, what the costs are of that. I mean, you've pointed to the issues that the Policing 2026 consultation is trying to grapple with. The financial position with Police Scotland is no great secret to anybody. Is there a concern that a combination of that lack of precision at the moment, perhaps, around what is pay for and cost structures, aligned to the financial difficulties Police Scotland are already in, that one would see an attempt, in a sense, to use these agreements as a way of bolstering finances in other parts of the organisation?
Well, let me make one small point and give way. It would be very difficult to know whether that's the case. I mean, one could say that, but I'm not saying that. I think most of the issues that we have with the costs of policing with the BTP at the moment are usually about how we share out the costs between ourselves, but we know it's a zero-sum game. At an aggregate level, we've had the pricing promise on RPI, and we've talked to them about where there are new expansions, you know, when territorial policing was set up in a new way, when we were deciding to arm part of the British Transport Police Force and so on, where there are additional costs and counter-terrorism as well. So those things, so in aggregate, we have a good relationship and a good understanding of how we handle costs. I think, you know, most of the thing you refer to actually when we argue about what are the methods of apportioning costs. Whereas I think it's a separate issue when you're talking about ceding that to a much bigger organisation with its own challenges. But let my colleagues comment.
Solicitor.
My comment would be similar, effectively, that it's really important to us that we have been given assurances that numbers would be retained, that any finance from the industry would be spent on railway policing and not in other areas. So it's important that those agreements do give that transparency in terms of ensuring that the costs are shared and known. So that.
But how robust is that, given what you've already said about, and it's been acknowledged by CC Higgins, in terms of the training requirement across the force? I mean, it's very easy to see a situation where costs that are force-wide can come to be met, perhaps not in whole, but certainly in significant part by the railway industry, and that training requirement is brought about through the railway policing agreements that Police Scotland and SPA have signed with yourselves.
I mean, that's clearly something that would need to be reviewed in detail. If there's a proposal there in terms of costs that look to being apportioned to the industry, then the industry would want to be able to understand those and ensure they're comfortable that they are allied to supporting the railway industry.
Okay. Are there any particular issues around the freight side of things in relation to either to that issue around the transfer of staff and officers across, or in terms of the way in which the contract may be structured?
Yeah, I think the comment you made earlier in regards to 40% people who are questioning whether they want to remain in the BTP is a big risk, because as we've all mentioned about the specialism that the BTP retain, if that's 40% of 250 approximate officers who are going to transfer over into Police Scotland, it's a significant loss of skill. And that really to me is something that needs to be identified as part and parcel of this process. Loss of that type of skill set will be obviously, you know, wherever they go to, that will leave 40% reduction in staffing levels, therefore an increase in required staff, and then further training to bring those that level of people back up to the 250 needed to support the BTP specialism that's been identified in, as mentioned by a number of police officers and a number of ministers, that this is key to retain that number of people as a specialism in Scotland. So our concern is that, you know, if that's happening now, what we're doing to make sure it doesn't happen. But also, then it just adds to a bill that's ever increasing all the time. When we start talking about further training, it is another cost to something, and somebody has to pay for this at the end of the day. And we've got to, as an industry, got to look at this and say, well, the policing is there, and we pay a levy to buy into that police force. And currently, it seems to me as though it's not fully understood how much is it going to cost us at the end of the day.
Just finally, do I get an impression from what you're saying? I mean, it's a fairly constructive attitude, I think, you've taken to the discussions you've had. But essentially, you need to make this work, because have you got anywhere else to go? Last week we heard from witnesses about a Dutch model where they'd gone down the route of bringing in private providers. Presumably that isn't something that you think is a realistic proposition in this instance, and therefore whatever happens through this legislation must be made to work.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, one shouldn't form the view that we're not very concerned about any transitional arrangements when this goes forward. You know, and I've had personal discussions with the Chief Constable where, you know, we're really concerned that we need to continue to police in accordance with the police service agreement we have at the moment. BTP has to satisfy that right up till, you know, 2359. So, you know, it's a concern now, and it's a concern about what those the implications of that sort of situation might be for the future. So it's, both issues are important to us.
It's the Meiklejohn.
Various things coming forward, but I don't think we can understate the importance of the people matters in this issue here. We represent an industry that went through significant change a couple of decades ago, and that had a profound impact on people who had built up their careers under British Rail. I think those who are members of the BTP today have got similar sort of issues going through them. It's recognised in the figure that you've quoted. There is an obligation to ensure that those fundamental people issues are addressed and taken into account to minimise the risk of people leaving the force unnecessarily. And I think going forward, we look on both sides of the borders, there's an opportunity for things to improve in Scotland, to then have the force in England and Wales to up their game and improve as well. So whilst we're obviously looking to protect what we have today, there's ways that we can use contracts and relationships to have a greater overall effect and improve efficiency and perhaps even lower costs.
Okay, and that subject clear?
Thank you, convener. So at the moment, as already stated, you have a commercial relationship with British Transport Police. And at the moment, there's a certain amount that you pay to British Transport Police, and you know what you get in return for that. Under the new proposed system, can you say about how you anticipate those costs being split between what you'll pay to the British Transport Police and what you'll pay to Police Scotland? Is there going to be, you know, is it as simple as a percentage amount that's taken off? Or Andrew Cooper talked about sometimes the difficulty of the operators deciding what the share is that goes into British Transport Police. is that going to be challenging in a Scottish context, looking at how operators, what share of their operations is carried out in Scotland? So how much of a challenge is dividing the existing cost going to be? And do you anticipate it being a more expensive model, the one that's being brought forward?
Stages. The Transport Police, I think, have advised the overheads and the direct costs that are associated with D Division. So there's no dispute, I think, about what costs are spent by British Transport Police for policing in Scotland at the moment. And under the Smith Commission's review, we shouldn't see any worsening on that position as a result of any change. So I think we know what the start position is. And those are the funds available to Police Scotland. And I agree, we'll have a discussion about the individual railway policing agreements, as they're to be called, in Scotland, about you know, how much that that is shared between operators in Scotland.
Because it would seem. I mean, I accept what you've said, but it would seem reasonable to anticipate that if you're splitting off at the moment a system that will have savings and cost efficiencies built within it, and you're splitting it into two, you would think the new system under Police Scotland would be more expensive. We've talked about concerns over capacity and specialism and these kind of areas, maybe the need for additional training, concerns about retirals. All this would suggest there'd at least be some initial higher costs, if not ongoing higher costs.
I think there's every reason to believe you're right. We kind of know what the start position is, and it'll be really for Police Scotland to assess, having taken on those responsibilities, you know, what the costs are to it. I think the concern for other operators that are not cross-border operators in the UK is that there are overheads which are covered by policing in Scotland, which are attributable to the BTPA. So that's an issue that's got to be tackled, because there are overheads, and obviously Police Scotland will no doubt allocate some of its overheads to railway policing in the future in Scotland. But equally, we've got operators in England who are left with without cover from Scotland, as it were. So somebody's got to work out how that happens. I think I said in my note, there's the funding to achieve devolution, then there's the one-off cost of implementing it, and then there's the ongoing costs, and we need to make sure those transitional issues are picked up. It really is an issue for discussion with Police Scotland as to whether they'll be able to, you know, meet the requirements that the industry places upon, you know, railway policing at the moment, generally, from the funds that come their way. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are statements made in some of the evidence I've read that they believe there'll be some economies of scale, but equally I read in some of the strategy documents that Police Scotland has already got its own challenges, so it's interesting to consider, you know, how they will go to provide both an efficient and an effective service to the railway. It'll be undoubtedly be a challenge, as it always is.
Does anyone else want to comment on the budgets or the anticipated costs of the new system?
Yeah. I think one thing, I agree, it's probably going to cost money. Like any change, it does reflect some benefits in the long term, but those benefits are quite a way out to actually see that benefit. But one thing I would like to see is some transparency during the costing models being developed to fully understand where the costing is going to and what it's going to be developed for. If there's additional costs coming in, we need to be clear and understanding why that's coming, and so we can see and reference it for the future. And obviously to make sure that the initial payment doesn't then suddenly start ramping up very quickly as well, to have that clarity and understanding.
My colleagues have said to my left, we expect transparency in the contract that we have with our franchise. The funding is the funding, and that's the funding that's available. So notwithstanding Scottish Police's own budgetary constraints, this is the proof will be in the pudding, I guess, is in the RPAs that are set up and the board that the railway or transport representative will sit on in terms of directing and allocating how funding is spent. Just picking up on a point that was made earlier about something's quite simple on the railway, but, you know, it takes 2 days of training with a personal track safety card. If as I read it, that each member of the officer is going to have a personal track safety card, it's going to be quite an expensive outlay. So it'd be very critical in terms of where our funding goes and what it's focused on. So the proof, as I say, will be in the pudding in terms of the board that will be set up and one of our transport members sitting on that and directing funding.
Yeah, I'd like to say, again, obviously commercially, it is very important for the rail operators, and in essence, from a cost perspective, there's two areas that this could potentially impact us. One is any transitional project costs in making this happen, and the RDG made the industry position clear that the industry isn't expecting to be picking up costs associated with the project that is delivering this change. And then there's the ongoing costs once the change has occurred. And on that area, it's encouraging to hear some evidence coming forward from the overall proposals, and that efficiencies should be able to deliver. And that's what one of the things that providing we can continue to deliver the safe and efficient service that we have today from BTP, and efficiencies can be delivered, then that would be received positively by the industry.
So, sorry, did you say there was clarity around setup costs, that you'd made it clear you didn't?
Well, no, what I'm saying is that there was evidence submitted by the RDG that indicated that the industry's position was that the project costs associated with this was something that the industry didn't believe it should be borrowing at, neither in England and Wales or in Scotland.
So that's not been clarified or agreed yet, or as far as you're aware?
I haven't heard detail on that.
Right. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Mr. Horley again?
The output of what my colleagues David says from RDG is expected around May, so that'll be published in terms of its findings.
This was an area where RDG did express quite a lot of concern: lack of detail, number of staff to be deployed, level of performance, and the point being made that you really do need some advance notice of this, you need some certainty to be able to budget. So can you comment further on that? Also, new contracts and being negotiated between England, Wales and Scotland, is there an aspect of concern in that specific area as well?
The service agreement we have at the moment has got a three-year notice period on it, which allows us to take those things into our medium-term financial plans. And I imagine that will be activated. So it does give us time to sort of put that into process. And I think that's the way we would handle it. I mean, the transitional costs, as my colleague has mentioned, are a concern because the Transport Police has no funding for it that I'm aware of in the discussions I've had on the Police and Security Committee. And certainly we don't as an operator. It's something that's come to us rather than has been part of our medium-term plan.
And in your submission, you say that there has to be a really good notice period given in advance for new contracts particularly. I'm quoting, given notice period, attendant uncertainties, proposal is unattractive to those with clear obligations, commercial responsibilities. That aspect of your evidence.
Yeah, I mean, it's my view, and no doubt we'll take legal advice on it, that the change that's being proposed here is sufficiently significant for notice to be given on the police service agreement that we hold with BTP. I think there are issues for other operators that are not cross-border operators who are affected financially but not operationally, and who won't require a second railway policing agreement with Police Scotland. Maybe a slightly different situation for them, but it would be freely for them to comment when they're faced with that challenge.
Okay. Mary then Douglas, or was it specifically on costs?
Just that one. Tiny question, and it's a yes no answer from one person, I think. When a territorial force attends an incident rather than BTP, is there any charge from the territorial force? I'm getting shaking heads. Right, we can move on, Camilla.
Mary and then Douglas.
Thank you. No, my first question was actually following on from Claire Baker's point and what she'd asked there, and really was about the concerns that were mentioned about the potential for increased costs, if you'd had any discussions, preliminary discussions about that, either with the government or, but I take it from your previous answers that hasn't been the case, or you're not aware of that being discussed at all? No. Okay, well, following on from that then, it's about the, in the submission from the Rail Delivery Group, and you've talked already about how some of the main issues have been around funding for the different services provided, how that's allocated, but are there any other issues about the current PSA other than that, or any other problems. I mean, the rail delivery group, that's what they talked about, and saying that the lack of any detailed description of the service to be provided to the operator by the supplier.
Without being flippant, I think, you know, it's always possible to improve the details in a contract, many of the ones we hold with all sorts of bodies. What I would say is that because we're talking about a supplier that simply supplies the rail industry, for the most part, they have one or two other small contracts. The best contracts are the ones you don't take out of the cupboard. And the relationship that we have and the alignment of objectives and the discussions we have at things like RDG's policing and security committee, which involves BTP as well, are such that, you know, if I had to refer to the contract, other than that budget time when clearly everyone's under pressure, so we have a discussion about, and hence the pricing promise, which I think has eased some of that in recent years, where we've had a long-term commitment to keep within RPI, which the BTP has done, despite some pressures on them. It does make it easier to leave the contract in the cupboard. This is not some short-term relationship. You know, it predates 2003 in terms of relationships, but the position we've had, I think, over the last 15 years has been really quite exceptional, and particularly under the current leadership. We really are in an extremely strong position with an alignment of objectives that's stronger than I've ever seen in my railway career. So if I had really to get the contract out of the cupboard, I would really be quite concerned, because I really do think that the working relationship is so strong and the financial commitments are so strong and the operational links work so well. And you have to remember that my staff are really the eyes and ears in the extended police force, and they know that because I've been telling them it for years. That, you know, they provide a lot of the intelligence which enables the police to work efficiently and effectively. So, you know, it's a very, very strong working relationship with a body that knows that, you know, its future depends on that relationship. So, yes, you can always improve contracts and you can always pin people down, but the question is that really the relationship you want? And in the mature one, which I think is the one I've described, I'm less concerned than I am entering in with a new supplier who's got other pressures as well.
Would anyone else like to comment on that?
I think as any contract as well, as Andrew's alluded to, it's the best left in the cupboard if you can operate that way. It's only when things start to go wrong do we then need to read to certain things. The concern I would have as well is we'll still need to maintain a contract with England and Wales, BTP. But what we need to ensure is the consistency of approach is still maintained regardless what country or what part of the UK we sit in, that we get a good value for money service that provides what we understand as a BTP service, that if we have a problem on the network, then it's dealt with in a professional manner, regardless of whether it's England, Wales or whether it's Scotland. And that's something that we need to be consistent with, because like insurance policies, I should say, you can tick every box you want, but there's always the little writing at the bottom that said it excludes this. So we need to make sure that it doesn't exclude anything.
I would echo, the comments from Mr. Cooper and Mr. Curtis there. And I think the RDG note does capture the key elements in relation to the development needed in the current PSAs or railway policing agreements. And I would concur that, you know, you want to have a positive relationship so the contract is less of an issue there. One of the areas that we are looking to enhance and develop is ensure that if there are changes occurring, so either costs go up or costs go down, then there's a getting together again to review what the impact of that and what changes could be made so that there's no surprises that occur 12 months down the line, etc. So that's the key, one of the key elements for us.
We've made comments in our submissions. I mean, the baseline would be that costs don't rise in Scotland and costs don't rise in England and Wales, but there has to be the process to be gone through. I think, as the other colleagues have said, I think it would be a failure of this process if we suddenly in Scotland had different parts of the industry are referring to contracts to go forward. It should just work in practice. We are fundamentally eager to see that relationship with BTP south of the border, because it will be that relationship that delivers the continuity across England, Wales and Scotland as well for all.
I just
I just echo my colleagues, the key words, are transparency, consistency, and fair allocation of costs. So it seems to be a common trend.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Are there any, I completely understand what you're saying and what you would like to see, but are there any other specific improvements that you think there could be or that you would like to see as part of any new agreement?
Improved efficiency. We did talk earlier on about targets and the way that things have worked. We're not for the moment looking at competition being introduced here, but to have standards and agreements in Scotland and then to have comparative neighbouring standards in England and Wales. We're two operators and Mr. Curtis as well, operating over the West Coast and the East Coast in and out of Scotland. And there's the opportunity for standards across the entire network to be delivered. And operationally, that's imperative for passengers in improving their overall experience of the railway, whether it's journeys in Scotland only, or whether it's using either of the Anglo-Scottish routes to make rail a more attractive mode to use rather than private car, flight, or any other choice.
I said it earlier, we look at it as an opportunity and cross-fertilisation in terms of best practice. If the merge does happen, let's get it right, involve us from the outset, which is the Minister has kindly done, spent quite a bit of time with us. But certainly it's an opportunity to get it right. Any of us have to get the contract out, we've all failed, in all honesty. So.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, the first is a supplementary I wanted to get in earlier, because a number of you, when you were answering the question about training, stated that the cost and the time involved to put everyone through the PTSC process and that has to be renewed, etc. What would your reaction be if Police Scotland said they're not going to do that? So you would expect when we get information back from ACC Higgins that every police officer will get this training and that will be continually upgraded and upkept, etc. That's useful to get on record. I also wanted then to move on. In terms of how BTP works on the trains, we've heard a lot about track policing on the trains, etc. What are your concerns or what benefits do you think there may be, if you think there are any, to policing within the station environment, and how much consideration do you give to that? For example, there may be a difference we now have with a single BTP force across the United Kingdom, the use of tasers in Scotland, which are used by all BTP officers, whereas if you are to use a taser as a Police Scotland officer, you must be firearms trained. Would you have concerns if we have a different operating model for policing around a transport network in Scotland, where all officers couldn't routinely use tasers, whereas just south of the border, the BTP officers could?
That's really something you need to address to the British Transport Police and Police Scotland. I mean, it's an operational matter for them. And I think we take guidance from them about the approach that they feel necessary to deal with the risks that exist to the railway and to its passengers and staff. So I think any view I expressed is not really one which is valid. So we take advice from them on these professional issues. They're the ones that assess the risk and we respond to that.
But ensuring optimum security within the station where you're clients come in and out must presumably be an important issue for you as well.
Yeah, oh, absolutely, indeed, yes, yeah.
Yeah, but the role that the BTP play is really important in providing reassurance to our staff and the travelling public, so it's critical for us that is maintained as it goes forward. As it says that we do want to ensure that they have the appropriate means to be dealing with the threats that they're faced with, but the police are the experts in determining what those appropriate means are. There are some potential opportunities in terms of enhancement for perhaps some of our less central belt, larger stations, where the wider Police Scotland team can provide some support for stations, etc., to provide that reassurance for staff and travelling public responding to concerns or incidents earlier. So that's one potential opportunity.
Although that is happening just now, presumably, as well. I mean, there's not routinely BTP officers at Elgin train station, but I have seen the police there. I've called the police ahead because of an incident on a train and they met the people there. So there is that working relationship happening.
Absolutely, but being part of one force, it just is something that can strengthen that particular element. There is the risk that there could be abstraction of police officers from the police stations at the railway to respond to an incident, and so that's one area that we would want to make sure that there's monitoring to ensure that that's absolutely that the railway policing is there for railway policing and not routinely abstracted for other areas. So that's one area we'd want to ensure is monitored.
In terms of our operation, we serve quite a large conurbations on our network: Manchester, Piccadilly, Edinburgh, Scotland, London, and I think a lot of it is the key word again: reassurance. And a question that you asked is certainly needs to be directed to the BTP, but it's about mitigation and visibility, and that forms part of the reassurance on our stations. We take guidance off the BTP, the forces and the measures that they would like to use, but it all comes back down to the partner relationship we've got in terms of reassurance to the passengers, to the staff, and the mitigation of events that happen on stations and trains as well.
And sorry, finally, I was just going to ask about the control and command element, the concerns. They were raised by BTP, I think even BTPA, and particularly given some of the IT problems we have within Police Scotland at the moment and continuing problems. What are your overall thoughts at the moment about that element of any potential merger?
It needs to be fully understood and agreed to. And systems that are going to be relied upon need to be robust and suitable to actually fulfil the need for command and control. Within the command and control setup, it's quite clear what, within people's emergency and business continuity plans, how that would work. Police are experts at that. They lead on that subject matter. We just need to ensure that when they need to invoke something, it is actually suitable and practical to actually achieve with the systems they've got and the number of police that can draw upon to deal with any incident that needs the command and control structure to be in place at any given time and any given location in the UK.
Can I ask them in response to that, at a time when Audit Scotland are raising significant concerns about the Field I-6 project, when the Scottish Government have overseen a number of questionable IT processes across the board, whether it's Police Scotland, whether it's in the NHS, whether it's in CAP, agriculture sector, is some of the SNP members don't like you saying this on the record, but there is a concern, and it's a palpable concern in communities, that there are issues about implementing ICT systems within Scotland. And is it a concern for you as operators, where you have a good working system, that you will be merged into a system that is currently not fit for purpose?
Well, just the point about command and control is essential. I mean, a couple of times this morning, people have talked about the response currently of Police Scotland to a railway incident. That's not going to change in the future. At ground level across the United Kingdom, Home Department forces, Police Scotland respond to incidents, as indeed do the British Transport Police when they happen to be in the vicinity when there's an issue off of the railway. At a working level, actually, there's not any change. It's the command and control structure. And we know this because if, a Home Department force officer gets there and is not quite dealing with the issue in the way that we might intend, it's because there is a control from BTP with a sergeant or an inspector there to take control of the situation and provide advice and so on, which is something from a dedicated railway control. And at the moment, the BTP has two, one that deals with London and the South East for obvious reasons, and the other one in Birmingham, which deals with the rest of the country. As it happens, it's just across the road from my team, and whilst they're looking after vehicles and policemen and so on, we're looking after trains and passengers and so on. But it's a very close map. And when my staff call for assistance and it goes through to BTP, there's a single control room, they know what's going on, and they respond accordingly. If they need to call on the services of Home Department Forces, they do that. That's very, very clear, and it gives confidence to people in the front line that they know how this arrangement works, and to our control team as well. We need to make sure that's replicated. IT and all the things that support that are very important indeed. All I can say is that things work okay as we are at the moment. There may be challenges elsewhere. I think my personal concern is, my understanding at the moment is that Police Scotland, despite the merger, have still got 4 control offices, which will come down to 3. And I just wonder what will happen when my staff are calling for assistance, how we will work out whether it's Glasgow, Edinburgh, Motherwell. Will somebody take the lead? Will they then pass the message on? It seems a little unclear at the moment. It might well be at this stage, because we haven't got into that level of detail. But if you stand back and look at it and say, well, there are 3 control offices for Scotland at the moment and 1 for the rest of our operations in England and Wales, one can see that it doesn't look as straightforward at the moment as it might do when things settle down.
We also have 8 legacy forces that don't even speak to each other at the moment, and I think that was a point that was raised by some of the BTP officials that were here.
Is there follow-on to the jurisdictional matters, lack of explicit provision in the legislation which would provide clarity on where specific powers lay? Is that something, Mr. Horley, did you want to add something to the line of questioning?
I just want to go back to the control centre. That is a key concern for us, and not just my members of staff that pick up the telephone to call for a member of or support from an officer, but also for staff on our services. With the help BTP, we've well-publicised that there's a 6106 number that a passenger can call for assistance. That does give us concerns, you know, where will that call go to, which control centre, and how will it be managed. Yeah. So they are. I have equal the concerns that my colleague Andy Cooper has raised, and likewise, I sit in an office in Birmingham, just across the road from the British Transport Police control centre in Birmingham, and we're very, very closely mapped. I think it was a good analogy.
Okay,
and
Mr. Lister.
Sorry, if I could just add to that point. You know, clearly, control is a critical element for us all. It's something that we've raised to ensure that the work stream that looks at that particular area is dealing with any risks. Training for the control staff in railway matters is another aspect that really needs to ensure it's considered, as well as we've talked a bit about the ethos that the British Transport Police have in responding to incidents, etc. And again, that ethos needs to be understood by control, who are directing the control of information around incidents, to ensure that what might be deemed as a low-level crime in the Home Office forces, but actually could be extremely disruptive or cause concerns for our staff or travelling public. So ensuring that it's understood the importance that particular crimes can be have in the rail industry.
Okay. John Finney.
There are many of us who are concerned at the constant talking down of Police Scotland. What we heard from ACC Higginson, indeed from the Chief Constable, I think on 2 occasions, and Mr. McBride, the senior police officer in Scotland, was that there's very good ongoing relationships between Police Scotland and BTP in Scotland. Of course, the situation elsewhere in the UK is that there'll be 44 relationships, because you have 43 home forces, and you would move from a situation to only having 1 control in Scotland. I wanted to particularly pick up on the threat, because we've heard both from Police Scotland and from the BTP that the transport network is a key component of the infrastructure of the country, and accordingly is a terrorist threat. So the questions alluded to about taser deployment, and that was discussed with all the political parties in here before it took place. That was a discussion that took place with presumably yourselves. The threat level is there's ongoing discussions with the rail operating companies. Am I correct?
When a strategic change like the implementation of an armed capability and the deployment of tasers, we are consulted on it, and we were.
Concludes. Oh, Fulton, very briefly.
Hey, thanks, panel. Apologies for being a wee bit later today. You'll be glad to know, particularly David Lister, that ScotRail was fine on my line, but it was the road network that ground to a halt with the snow in the west. I just want to, I will keep it brief, and a couple of points, but I'll keep it quite brief.
You need to be very brief.
I heard there a few people mention opportunities. And I wonder if somebody would like to expand on what those opportunities could be. Are we talking about a Scotland-specific situation? And how do you think you could get involved in that?
refer to an opportunity. I mean, an opportunity to A, build further relationships and cross-fertilisation of training, so best practice. So if what Mr. Higgins is telling me that that the forces, a BTP force or the Rail Division force, or whatever it looks like, is going to be further enhanced, well, you know, maybe best practice is shared with the current BTP that resides, that's left in England and Wales. So when I say opportunity, it's an opportunity to get it right and get also get this new structure right, should it be passed, and to work with us.
This was covered in earlier evidence. We did look at some of the positives. Is there anything that you think hasn't been covered, Fulton, that you want to ask?
No, I'm okay then. That's
okay. Can I thank you all very much for attending today and for very worthwhile evidence. I now suspend briefly to allow for a change of witness. I welcome our next witness on the Railway Policing Scotland Bill, Dan Moore, Deputy Director, Rail Market Strategy, UK Department of Transport. Can I have questions from the members, please? Starting with... Don't all rush at one. Rona?
Good morning, Mr. Moore. Could I ask you if you could give us a sort of general update on the work of the JPB? And what issues has been discussed at meetings so far? Where are we with it at the moment?
No, I'm very, very happy to do so. But first of all, can I just say a very substantial thank you for the invitation today. We do think this is a really important programme. I think you've heard a lot this morning about the value of the British Transport Police, and we're very committed to ensuring an orderly and sensible transfer should the Scottish Parliament decide to go ahead with the legislation before it. But just turning to the JPB in particular, it may be helpful I say one or two words about the JPB and then just give you a general update as to where we are. So the JPB is very much a manifestation of how important it is to us that this process is managed in an orderly way. So what we've tried to do is to work in genuine partnership and collaboration with the Scottish Government, but also with a range of different parties, such as the authorities and the forces, just to have a fairly open dialogue at the Joint Programme Board. So what we've tried to do through that is make sure that a range of issues are raised on an ongoing basis. So one choice that we made quite early in the process was that quite a lot of the JPB's work would be essentially affected through a number of individual work streams, which cover a full range of transition issues, ranging from the really important people questions to the assets and liabilities to the financial questions. And they've been up and running now for some time. Where we are at the moment is actually the JPB has met on 7 or 8 occasions now, so it's a fairly advanced process. It's absolutely fair to say that quite a lot of the initial meetings were on getting things set up and on legislative questions, particularly as the Scotland Bill was becoming an act in the UK Parliament. The critical question now for the JPB is across all of those work strands that I've mentioned, and I'm very, very happy to talk in more detail about any of them, that we have fully flushed out all of the issues, that we can plan and identify them in the right sort of way. Because I would really want to emphasise that we do see this as a very complicated and difficult challenge to make it work in the right sort of way. So what we've tried to do is to make sure that certainly by the next Joint Programme Board, which is meeting in a week's time, that we've tried to identify all of the issues across the various work streams. And it may be helpful, I just give you an example of one of those particular areas as an illustration of where we are. So when it comes to the critical question of staff, and I can't emphasize enough how critical it has been for us to understand the implications for both officers and staff of this move, what we've been doing over the last couple of months is making sure that we fully understand the range of issues, whether they be the important pension issues, the terms issues, and seeking professional advice from the Government Actuaries Department, but also having broader discussions so that we fully understand all of the issues. And my sense is that by trying to get to the bottom of what the issues are, that the next year is essentially about fully resolving those issues so we have a clear set of answers for staff as soon as we possibly can. I'm very happy to say a little bit more about each individual strand, but I think I'm trying to give you a flavour that where I think we are at the moment is issue identification and trying to make sure that we have a full plan to address those issues. There is still a lot of work to do to manage this process in the right way.
Just on that,
of course.
Can you give us an idea of how timescale, how it's working? And also, has it been sort of harmonious so far, would you say?
I think it's been... I'm not sure the arrangements also always between the UK and Scottish governments are harmonious, but I think this has been a highly harmonious and highly collaborative process. And I think that's been the case from day one. So I think both the discussions that we have had over the course of the last 16 months have seen us, I think, having very open conversations. And I think one of our basic rules for the Joint Programme Board is this is not a talking shop. It's not something where we get together and say how great the programme is. If there are problems with the programme or issues with the programme, we discuss them. We discuss them frankly. And I think that spirit of frankness and openness has been incredibly important. And my sense at the moment is that it is a genuine joint effort to try to understand and resolve issues. Now, that clearly doesn't come at the cost. We very much recognise that we have different perspectives in some respect, or different fundamental interests. So the United Kingdom government's interest will always be substantially on ensuring that the cross-border operations are managed in the right way, to ensure that if the Scottish Parliament proceeds to pass this bill into an act, that there is an effective protection for the interests of England and Wales after the transition has occurred, where clearly the focus on of Scottish ministers will necessarily be on ensuring that the service works in the right sort of way in Scotland as well as on the cross-border areas. But my strong sense is that it's been a highly collaborative and highly coordinated process to this point.
Okay, thank you.
You mentioned terms and conditions, and I presume that would come under workforce project and pension work stream.
That's right.
But the fact of the matter is we don't think to appeal or apply, but at this point in time, the workforce have no idea just exactly what their terms and conditions will be. So how much of a priority is this going to be, and what kind of time scale can you give us an assurance that this will be resolved?
Absolutely. So I can't emphasise that. It is an absolute priority, and you're entirely right with the 2P position. I think we're now comfortable that the COSUP, the Cabinet Office Statement of Practice, is an appropriate means to effect an orderly transfer process. And I think we're also very conscious of the triple lock guarantee that's been given by the Scottish Government in this sort of area. My strong sense on this one, Convener, is that a really important milestone for this project is the introduction of secondary legislation to the UK Parliament later in the year, whereby quite a number of the transitional questions will have to be properly resolved by that point. So my sense is that if we haven't been in a position to give a substantially greater level of assurance as we get into the late summer, then I think we are going to have some challenges. But I do think it's really important for me, and I would stress this, that it's incredibly important for the Scottish Government to be in the position to provide, as ultimately the likely employer, if the Scottish if the Scottish Parliament passes this bill, to be able to provide that sort of reassurance as soon as practically possible. And we do think that the triple lock guarantee is a very good first step in that sort of area.
So basically then, by the time we reach the end of our stage one process, which is likely to be early May, we still won't really have a definitive idea of exactly what the terms and conditions will be, and neither will the workforce.
I think these are complex issues, to be sure, and I think it is absolutely the case that it will take us a bit of time to properly work through them in the right sort of way. My sense at the moment is that what we're trying to do, and particularly what the Scottish Government are trying to do, is to give as much assurance as possible at this point, but I think there will still be issues that we need to work through over the summer period as well.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I was interested, obviously my constituency's right on the border. I wondered how much the Joint Programme Board had focused on that section of railway, particularly on the West Coast main line between Carlisle and Lockerbie, and whether there had been any detailed discussions around how that section of the network would be managed.
So there's been quite a lot of discussion in relation to cross-border questions more generally, so both on the East and West Coast main lines. And I think it's fair to say that one of the strongest interests of the UK government in this particular process, and which has been manifested in the discussions with the Joint Programme Board, is that there is a seamless and effective process of cross-border policing. So there is an individual work strand on this question set up as part of the Joint Programme Board. It's effectively an operational-based work strand, which is led by Police Scotland and led by the British Transport Police. And it is trying to get to brass tacks on these questions of the cross-border arrangements. So they can be they can come up in a number of different ways. So it could be, what's the nature of the operational relationships that we need to see? What are the agreements that we need to see in place to ensure cross-border policing? But also, one of the important mechanisms for effecting devolution will be statutory instruments, which effectively set out some of the jurisdictional questions at a later point in the process. So we have been thinking very carefully about how those statutory instruments should be framed. But the guiding principle that we've been trying to work to is effective and seamless cross-border policing, and that is an ambition which I think the Scottish Government have also expressed on a number of occasions, and I think we're moving in the right direction there. And to give you reassurance, it is of substantial importance both to the Joint Programme Board but also to both ministers in the Scotland Office and the Department of Transport.
Thank you.
Ben?
Following on in the vein of questioning from the convener around terms and conditions, but firstly stating how encouraging it is to see that the enthusiasm for partnership and collaborative working that you've expressed in your initial statements, I think that should be noted and commended. But I wanted to come on to the issue of pensions that you mentioned in the opening statement. I just wondered if you could illuminate perhaps on where things are at with pensions, what the different strands of discussion are, whether it's about continuing openness for members to maintain the membership of their current scheme or opening membership to other schemes or creation of a new scheme. Just is there a line of thought that's being progressed, or are all options still being explored?
So, I would say it's a really important area. So again, there's a particular, as the convener's mentioned, there's a work strand on pensions. And I think the main... The short answer is a number of options are still open at this stage,
right.
Both in terms of thinking about the implications of remaining within current arrangements or thinking about future arrangements. We do so in the context of a very clear position, as this being one of the three aspects of the triple lock which the Scottish Government has talked about. But I think what we are absolutely doing at this stage is making sure we fully understand the implications, both for the staff, but also, as you'd expect, for financiers of any sort of transfer arrangement. So all options are on the table, but I can't emphasise enough, when we've been talking about these issues, money clearly is important. Public financing is clearly important. You wouldn't expect me to say anything else. But providing the right sort of approach to the appropriate transfer of the staff has been an important, really important aspect. And I think you heard that very clearly from the Chief Constable when he was before you a couple of weeks ago, as being a really important thing that the BTP and the BTP are continually bringing to the table. So I apologise, that's a somewhat woolly answer. We're
no,
still...
it's helpful though, just to get an indication of where things are at right now. And I think considering different arrangements, from my own perspective, seem as an appropriate course of action, given that there will be individuals who will have pension conditions at the moment that they will hope to maintain and look to maintain, and it's good that that's being progressed. So
we're certainly considering that carefully. Yes.
Has it been taken into account if this isn't resolved and there's still a question mark? People may just walk with their feet rather than wait to see if the uncertainty is going to be resolved to their advantage or not.
I think that's an absolutely fair point. And we, when we're managing risks as part of the Joint Programme Board, the risk of effectively people leaving what is a highly specialist, highly important organisation is absolutely there. So what we're trying to do is to provide as much certainty as soon as possible, given the, but taking into account the complexity of the situation. But also we are trying to work with the BTP in providing, in ensuring that and as much certainty is provided and as much clear messaging is provided as soon as possible. To give you some reassurance, convener, when we look at the risks that we're trying to manage in relation to this particular project, that question about loss of expertise is very much at the top of that list.
Liam, please.
Just on that point, obviously you've outlined the efforts that have been made to address the concerns that have been raised about terms and conditions around point of transfer. Similarly, there will be concerns, no doubt, within Police Scotland itself, going through its own consultation on how that force will look going forward. How are you balancing the risk of loss of expertise, loss of officers and staff, and therefore expertise, different people concerned about their own terms and conditions and how that might be affected by the transfer, with the risk that the Police Scotland, to which BTP will be folded, will have its own anxieties if officers and staff are coming into that organisation on what are seen to be far better terms and conditions and arrangements than those in the existing force.
So I think that's a very, very fair point, and I think it is one of the points that we're just trying to understand as part of the work. So one thing I want to really communicate to the committee is that although we've been meeting for some time and actually has been a considerable amount of work, we recognise that this is the stage at which some of those really difficult and complex issues need to be fully worked through, and trying to understand the sort of the implications for individuals and the sort of circumstances that they would go into is absolutely an important part of the project as we go on. And my sense, or my strong sense, is that a lot of these issues will depend upon the approach that the Scottish Government ultimately takes to questions of pensions and other things, which is why, again, we've been so encouraged by the triple lock position and the sort of reassurances that I think you heard from Mr. Higgins a couple of weeks ago as well. So, again, that's this is essentially an answer which says this is a significant work in progress, but that's something we're very, very aware of.
And is that discussion approaching it from the perspective that there are individuals who are transferring and it's their interests that we need to be focused on, but those who come up in their wake, so to speak, those who are being recruited or maybe recruited in the coming years, will have to be taken on terms and conditions that are more reflective of what exists at the moment within Police Scotland. What's the strategy around handling those who are currently in the service and those who presumably will be being recruited over there?
Yeah, absolutely. It is fair to say that our focus at the moment is very much providing reassurance and providing as much clarity for those who are currently in the service as we possibly can. My sense is what we have to be clear about over the course of the next several months is how we see the workforce strategy going forward. And again, Mr. Higgins was able to give some reassurance on that a couple of weeks ago. But that, for me, is one of the most important aspects of the workforce work stream that we've set up as part of the Joint Programme Board, to really get under those issues and provide as much certainty as we possibly can.
I think you've fairly outlined the fact that a lot of the detail around this will be taken forward in secondary legislation. And
that's indeed
probably an understandable approach, but there will be concern that whatever is agreed in broad terms, once you drill that down into secondary legislation, may have either some unintended or unexpected consequences. What level of assurance can you give that consultation around those the secondary instruments will be sufficient to allow any of those concerns to be teased out, rather than the situation which I think in this Parliament we've seen on many occasions, where in a sense you end up with a piece of secondary legislation where effectively you're given a take it or leave it option, which didn't necessarily do justice to the complexity of the issues.
And I think this has to be a collaborative process over the next 6 months. So one of the things that we've tried to do with each of the individual work strands is to establish a clear lead. So on workforce questions, the British Transport Police Authority as the employer acts as the clear lead on that sort of area. But the BTP is also very, very involved. And we would envisage not just further conversations, but an active process of dialogue with the British Transport Police Federation and with others over the course of the next several months as we're trying to work some of these questions out. Now, I'm conscious, and I think it was quite illuminating from the panel this morning, the comments that were already made about the level of dialogue that there has been with Scottish ministers. And I'm very conscious that a number of these decisions ultimately will be questions for Scottish ministers. And my sense is that we're moving in a fairly collaborative and open sort of way. My sense, however, is that we will also need to uptick the engagement over the next couple of months, both with the operators, but also with staff representatives, to make sure that we know We fully understand exactly the point, Mr. MacArthur, that you're making about the sort of unintended consequences, the how it works out in the detail. I've been certainly in circumstances that you've described of secondary legislation which doesn't quite work out in the way that we would have wanted it to. And I'm very, very committed to making sure over the next several months that this is a collaborative process with the representatives, those most directly impacted. And to some extent, this was a really big choice from us at the start of the joint programme. We had two basic choices. We could have effectively tried to put in place a highly centralised project structure with a very substantial project management unit and a project management core. What we've tried to do is, however, by using these work streams to make sure that we're using both the experts, the day-to-day experts, those who understand all of these issues to be actively taking forward the work, but also those who are closest to the operators, closest to the staff, so they're able to identify issues which as a central board we may not immediately identify. And I'd like to hope that the reassurance of the approach that we're trying to take in this sort of area of being as close as possible to those who know best about these questions ultimately will result in exactly those sort of issues being properly picked up. But I really can't emphasize enough in the discussions in the board the real importance of understanding the practical staffing impacts. That's really very important to us.
Could I be clear that, for example, there'd be actual formal consultation with people like the Law Society of Scotland who may have very definite views on the statutory instrument?
So one point I'd make is, some of the formal, as it were, consultative process, I'm always wary of speaking directly for the Scottish Government on this. There will be a number of Scottish Government issues, and ultimately quite a lot of this process must be, and consistent with the devolution process, must be driven by decisions made by yourselves and by the Scottish Government. So I don't want to speak too much about their process. In terms of the statutory instrument process, so there are a couple of statutory instruments that we would effectively look to effect transfer through. And I don't know if this is the time to get into some of that detail, but there are two statutory instruments that we would look to effect the transfer through: a Section 90 order, which would be effectively transferring assets and liabilities, which would be subject to the scrutiny of this Parliament, as well as the United Kingdom Parliament, and the Section 104 order, which would be a UK Parliament measure, but which would cover a range of jurisdictional consequential issues. I would absolutely see that being the process of engagement and discussion. We haven't, at this stage, established exactly the formal public consultation process that we would follow, but I can't emphasize enough that the premium that we place on engagement and the premium that we've placed on engagement throughout the joint program board process from its first day, it's one of our guiding principles. So I would not want anybody to come to this committee in 2 years' time on a question that the United Kingdom government has as a matter of its responsibility and say, the United Kingdom government has not given us an opportunity to be heard. And I think that's what we're trying to secure as part of this process.
I appreciate that. And perhaps taking that a little bit further, you may take on board that dialogue and discussions behind closed door are one thing, but a formal consultation process gives the opportunity for responses to be seen, for transparency to be quite clear and accountability to follow. So I hope you take that on board.
I will certainly take that away, and I very much agree with the spirit of that, but let me take it away.
Could we move on to John Finney, followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Moore, and thank you for evidence. 2 points I'd like to raise with you, and it is just on that last one of engagement. I don't know if you heard Mr. Steele, the General Secretary of the Scottish Police Federation's evidence last week. And if it wasn't him that specifically said this, I think Mr. Higgins would have alluded to it too. And that is, already within Police Scotland, there are a range of terms and conditions, not least regarding issues like formerly housing allowance and pensions. There's difference. So this would be another complication thrown into the mix. Is there engagement with the Scottish Police Federation by your board at all?
So at this stage, there hasn't been a strong process of engagement. There absolutely will have to be as part of this process going on. So we've identified essentially a group of parties that we've broadened the board in the last couple of months to include the forces. We would envisage a greater level of engagement with the Scottish Police Federation, the Military Transport Police Federation throughout. from now on. But I would absolutely emphasise, and this absolutely is something which Scottish Government colleagues may be able to say more of, that when they come before you next week, that there has been a very extensive set of discussions with Scottish Government colleagues and the Scottish Police Federation and with other representative organisations to try to understand their interests. Because I'm very conscious that quite a lot of the practical day-to-day decisions will ultimately be decisions for the Scottish Government. So in many respects, quite a lot of the consultation in this sort of area must follow that sort of decision-making tree, as it were.
Okay, thank you. And were the Scottish Parliament to adopt this legislation, a question, please, about operational issues. Now, there's long-standing conventions between the Dumfries and Galloway, as it would have been, in Cumbria, Lothian borders, and Northumbria, and indeed, the convener and myself would have been involved in the single service where this issue came up. And similarly, we dealt with a piece of legislation about hot pursuit at sea, if you recall, in the last session, convener, where, again, there was issues of jurisdiction. Now, clearly, BTP have existing arrangements for that. I'm just wondering the extent, and I don't envisage that they'll necessarily change. Is there engagement with, for instance, the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service and their opposite number, presumably the Crown Prosecution Service in England, that would address some of the concerns about what to me seem doable issues of addressing where a crime's alleged to have been committed and then where it would...
It's a very reasonable point. I'm afraid I can't give you a detailed answer on that one. My expectation is that those arrangements do exist. But the really important question, I really want to get this level of reassurance across to the committee today, that on a range of those questions, those practical operational questions, we are very much relying upon the specialist expert judgment of the British Transport Police to tell us what it needs in this sort of area. So whether that's about practical hot pursuit questions, it's the range of day-to-day operational questions, what we're comfortable with and what we had to be comfortable with before we went down this particular route was that we had a sensible set of arrangements to ensure seamless cross-border policing. And you very fairly, Mr. Finney, refer to the existing very good bilateral arrangements that exist across the border. We want to strengthen those on railway policing issues, and we want to ensure that the legislation that goes through the UK Parliament, Section 104 order I referred to, that we've done all the necessary work through the Joint Programme Board to be fully clear about all those jurisdictional questions before that legislation gets to the UK Parliament. So I would give you a reassurance that this is, again, one of the top issues upon our particular agenda, and we're relying to a substantial degree on those, again, who know best, the British Transport Police, to advise us on that.
Thank you very much. Of course, that's very important for a reason that goes beyond the legislation we're looking at, and that is the security issue around particularly the threat of terrorism, where some very minor incident. So if we don't have these procedures right, and that's an obligation not just for Scotland, the rest of the UK collectively, it's a global issue, of course.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we're very conscious about that. And I'm also very conscious about the existing arrangements between Home Office forces in England and Wales and Police Scotland. And I know Mr. Higgins talked about those a little bit when he was before you 2 weeks ago. And I think those arrangements are incredibly, incredibly important. And what we're clear about is that the transport policing reforms, if they are adopted by the Scottish Parliament, that they shouldn't inject any degree of security or other issue into what are arrangements that work well.
Okay, many thanks for that.
You're Baker.
Thank you, Convener. The previous panel, we discussed the issue of the possibility of one-off costs of who meets the project costs. Is that been looked at by the Governance and Finance Group within the board?
So
I was going to say, is it the operators believe it's, or put the case that it's not their responsibility, would the responsibility then lie with the Scottish Government, as that's what's been discussed?
So I think there are two questions here. So costing questions have occupied a reasonable proportion of the board's time over the last couple of months. And a lot of the questions are just understanding what the cost questions are, both the transitional costs, but also any longer term costs that arise in this area. Now, what we've very much tasked the British Transport Police Authority to do is just to make sure that we fully understand those costs and cost implications over the next several months, so we can take a view on the appropriate allocation of those costs. So it is absolutely fair to say this is a matter still under discussion. In relation to the operators' points, I've heard the RDG point very, very loudly, and I've had many discussions with the RDG over the course of the last several months on this question of the transitional cost issue. At this stage, our starting position is there are a number of legislative changes which affect the British Transport Police on an annual basis. My team deals with a very substantial number of Home Office pieces of legislation which go through the United Kingdom Parliament, which impose a degree of cost. To some extent, that we would see this being essentially based on a similar basis, i.e. it will be a chargeable cost to the operators. But I have very much heard their concerns in this sort of area. And that's why what we're doing is trying to push this question as far as we possibly can, so you understand what the delta is, what the level of cost is, so we can make an appropriate decision as to how it should be allocated.
Right, so there's no, at the moment, there's no clarity about what would be established as transitional costs, about who meets the transitional costs.
So
is it possible it would be the operators? Or so I know it's maybe not your decision.
No, it's
your decision
it's,
to me, but if you can be.
No, it's a very, very fair point. So speaking frankly, our starting position, the UK government's starting position, is that this is a chargeable expense, so it would be paid by the operators in the normal way. But also, I'm very conscious about the strong positions that strong representations that the operators have made both this morning, but also as part of discussions to date. And what we've effectively asked the British Transport Police Authority to do, and they've been doing for some time, is just understanding the scale and nature of those costs so we can reconsider if they should be dealt with in a different way. I apologise, that's not quite a comprehensive answer, but I think it's fair to say we are genuinely trying to listen to operators as we go through this process, and we are willing to think again about some principles in order that we can affect this process in the most collaborative and sensible way.
So you've said it's the UK government to decide. The UK government believe it to be a chargeable cost, but this legislation has not been brought forward by the UK government. It's been brought forward by the Scottish government. But is it because the way in which it's constituted at the moment, it comes down to the UK
government? It's the way that it's constituted at the moment.
It's not their legislation or their decision.
No, indeed. And I think this is exactly where the challenge becomes, because essentially what happens at the moment is there's a lot of changes made on an annual basis in relation to the BTP, a lot of changes. And what that normally results in is cost implications for the operators who directly pay for and benefit from the policing service. Our starting proposition was that this was a change like any other, but we're also very conscious about the representations that have been made both today and previously. So we want to understand the nature of the costs further in order to make a better, clearer decision on that question. But I think one thing I would really make clear is that there is a substantial interest in the operators ensuring that the right arrangements are in place for transfer. As I mentioned earlier, we want to make sure that the arrangements work on a cross-border and in England and Wales basis well into the future, well past the 1st of April 2019 if the devolution takes place at that point. So there was a strong interest on the part of operators to make sure that any arrangements that are put in place over the course of the next couple of years continue to work for cross-border and England and Wales policing after that particular point. So we think there is a reasonable argument in that area, but I have very much heard the points that have been made by the RDG.
And one final point. It's anticipated that there will be a very busy legislative programme at the UK Parliament over the next couple of years. Are you confident about the timescale that's been put in place?
So
there will be space for the legislation that's anticipated?
So this has been on our radar for some time, and we have done what we can to program that in. As I sit here today, I'm comfortable that we've done enough in order that this particular secondary legislation, I'd stress it was secondary legislation, I think it's primary legislation, there may be a bit more of a question, but I feel that there's enough there that we should have confidence in the date. The critical question for me on the date is that, I don't want to leave the committee in any doubt about this, there is a huge amount of work to do between now and the 1st of April 2019. And what we really need to be in a position to do through the Joint Programme Board is make sure that work is properly done. And I think the greater risk to the date would arise if that work isn't taken forward in the most orderly manner. So I'm not factoring at the moment any risk in relation to parliamentary time, not least because it's been on our, as it were, forward agenda for some time.
Okay, thank you. Can I just be clear? The trail operators, you heard and you referred to some of their evidence today, they want to be consulted from the outset. Has the Joint Programme Board formally met with them and consulted?
So as chair of the Joint Programme Board, I've met with the RDG several times, including meeting with their policing and security representative last week. And we will continue that process of detailed engagement. If the RDG is one of our most important stakeholder groups in this sort of area, and we will absolutely keep that process of engagement ongoing. And that includes both the sort of bilateral discussions, but also discussions in the RDG PNS Committee, the Policing and Security Committee, which Mr. Cooper talked about as a really important forum. We absolutely need to see that continuing.
That's fine, thank you. Douglas Ross.
Ask a question. We heard some issues from ScotRail and others today about the governance arrangements. Could you give us some details about the discussions that the board have had over governance going forward?
So the main discussions so far have been for us to go through some of the benefits that we see of having bespoke governance arrangements in place. So we've talked previously with, in the context of the board, about the sort of arrangements that the British Transport Police Authority currently have. So the core aspects being that they are able to set policing objectives which reflect operator priorities, that are able to plan in a way which reflects the specialism and priorities of the force, and they're able to hold the force accountable to deliver. And what we've tried to do is just to talk through some of those questions. And we were quite, speaking frankly, we were quite pleased to see that the forum suggestion that is before you in the legislation, because we do think there is one of the really important aspects of this is the specialism and maintaining the specialism of this particular, quite in my view, special force. And that governance arrangements which reflect that, I think, are incredibly important. And we do think that the forum arrangement, if properly implemented, has many of those sort of flavours of maintaining that sort of focus on the specialism.
Although decisions will still be taken by the Scottish Police Authority and the single Chief Constable for the whole of Police Scotland, and there are concerns within this Parliament, indeed this Absolutely. Committee, about scrutiny at the role of the SPA. We indeed had set up and still have a separate subcommittee specifically on policing, which does a lot of the work many expected the SPA to do. Is that not a concern that we still have an authority in Scotland where people have concerns about their ability to scrutinise and lead Police Scotland in terms of the strategies, leaving the operational side to the Chief Constable, and we're now adding in another layer to this with the potential merger of BTP?
I understand that point. I suppose this is one of those areas where I feel a little reluctant to get into too much detail, largely because I do think that the governance arrangements have to be fundamentally a matter for the Scottish Government as it brings forward its proposals in this particular area. And I think where the Joint Programme Board adds some value in this sort of area is by demonstrating the value of ensuring that governance arrangements support the effective provision of a specialist policing force. But I'm very, very conscious about the UK government specifically commenting upon particular governance arrangements, and particularly the arrangements in relation to the Scottish Police Authority. But Mr. Ross, if I could give you some reassurance, the level of discussion that I've had over the last couple of months with the Scottish government on maintaining specialism is very substantial. And it comes through in all of the documents about that sort of important recognition of specialism. That wasn't there when we started this Joint Programme Board process 18 months ago. I think the Scottish Government recognised the importance, but it didn't underline it in the way that it has in the last several months. So I do think that's a very strong foundation point to build on.
I think that's an interesting point. However, my concern would be there are many things in the bill that introduced Police Scotland and a single fire and rescue service. One of them was that the SPA should be open, transparent, and show good governance. Now, we are seeing week after week that the SPA doesn't provide that at the moment, and we'll see what happens at their board meeting on Wednesday. But I think I would just make a final point on what you're saying. It's all very good to get that language coming from the Scottish Government. What we need to see before MSPs vote on this is that it will be implemented in any scrutiny body, any governance arrangements going forward. So while language is useful at this stage, we need some evidence that that will happen. And I'm just concerned of all the topic headings that you have that
matters for the Scottish Government. I think Mr Moore has really answered that question.
I was just going to finish the point about the project. I was just trying to get the number of projects, but of the project schemes, governance and finance are put in together. In terms of the time you're dedicating to these different schemes, are they all equal, these different projects, or is governance an area that is getting less attention paid to it?
So I think it's fair to say that it varies depend upon the issues under discussion, and it is absolutely fair to say that the ones which have taken a significantly greater amount of time in recent months have been the legislative aspects for probably quite understandable reasons given the bill before this Parliament, but also the proceedings in the House of Lords last year. I think governance has got just rewind one point, I think the things that have got most coverage within the context of the Joint Programme Board have been a combination of workforce and operational questions, most particularly that cross-border issue which we've talked about. I think governance has received relatively less prominence, but I don't think that's because it's understated in importance in the discussion so far. It's because I think the Scottish Government have very much been emphasising the importance of governance arrangements which preserve specialism for some time. But we do see this, and I take the convener's point very clearly here. I do think that ultimately is a question for the Scottish Government.
If you can't give an answer just now, perhaps you could write to us for a timescale in completing each of the work streams, but in particular under the operational one, the jurisdictional issues, which seem pretty fundamental.
No, I'm very, very happy to do so. My sense is, if it's convenient with the committee, is that the Joint Programme Board will meet again in a week and a bit's time to discuss and review the project. And if it would be possible to provide an update to the committee after that particular discussion and after you've had the minister before you, I think that would be a good point at which to provide an update. I'd be very, very happy to do so.
I think the committee would very much appreciate that. That concludes our questions. Can I thank you very much for attending today?
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Okay, thank you. We now send briefly to allow the witness to leave. I think that shouldn't take too long. And move on, I think. Yeah, the agenda item number 3 is feedback from the Justice Committee on Policing on its meeting on the 16th of March. Following the verbal report, there will be an opportunity for brief comments and or questions. And I refer members to paper 3, which is a note by the clerk. And as Mary Fee is absent today, I will provide this feedback to the effect that the Justice Committee on Policing met on the 16th of March, when it took evidence from the Auditor General for Scotland on the 2015-16 audit report on the Scottish Police Authority. The subcommittee heard about the lack of a long-term financial strategy for Police Scotland and about ongoing governance issues. The subcommittee will next meet on Thursday, 30th of March, when it will take evidence from the Auditor General on Audit Scotland's I6 report. And as ever, all members of the committee are very welcome to attend. Do members have any questions? There being no questions, then we now move into private session. The next meeting of the committee will be on 23rd of March, when we'll consider our report on the Crown Office inquiry. And we're now in private session.